Okay, I see something. Good morning. How many of you know Rx, the library? Some. How many of you ever fixed a bug with set timeout zero? Come on, everybody, everybody, right? This is your talk. I did another talk on scheduling at Angular Connect last year. If you're interested on some of the basic knowledge, just watch this one. The current talk is way cooler. The current talk is about RxJS 7 and scheduling. And let me start with the animation frame scheduler. Well, I was doing a lot of experiments last year with scheduling, and I ran into a pretty interesting bug. And I tweeted about it. I was like, I'm sure if you're using the animation frame scheduler, you're using it in the wrong way. And a lot of people do it like this. They try to run a task at 60 frames per second on the animation frame scheduler. So I will show you some experiments that hopefully will confuse you. So what we see is three circles animated. And I have two text boxes. Just one of those text boxes is important. It's this one. It's the tick, the speed, how fast every animation step is running. And every circle is animated with a different scheduler. The blue one is the important one. This is animated with the animation frame scheduler. Now please watch what happens if I decrease the milliseconds. And now I have 1 millisecond. And please try to watch the blue circle if I switch to 0 milliseconds. Okay, I switch back. And again to 0. So if you realize it, when I switch to 0, something strange happens. The blue circle starts to animate in a different speed, or let's say the green and red start to speed up. We can do another test. We can try to stress the browser. And I spend a lot of time creating code to stress my browser. I did some crazy operations, I did a lot of console log, and after several hours of trying to stress my browser, I found out that there's a really easy way to stress the browser. You just resize the window. So, now I'm stressing the browser. Works, right? Brilliant, brilliant. Okay, watch the blue circle. Now, it's faster. If I stress, stop the stress, they jump back. So, this is a way how you can test if you really run animations on an animation frame scheduler and not on any other thing. But why is it only working if you switch to 0? I hope that's confusing. At least it was for me. My name is Michael. I'm a self-employed trainer and developer, and my focus is on Angular, RxJS, and state management with tools like Redux. Let's get back to the table of content, and what I will talk about today is everything new in RxJS 7. If you want to check out the current pull request, you can see there is a lot of change, everything related to schedulers. In this talk, you will see bug fixes, deprecations, updates, some refactorings and rewrites, and of course, a new operator, to be more specific, a new creation method. Let's start with bug fixes. So, you remember this crazy situation with the blue circle and the animation frame? After some reverse engineering, I found out the problem. So there are schedulers, and inside of schedulers are actions, and there is this line here where you see if the delay is bigger than 0, you fall back to the asynchronous scheduler. So this means nobody ever ran animations on the animation frame if you used the timeout, and most of us did. So it would only work with 0. This bug is fixed in version 7, and you now can really delay something and still run it on the animation frame scheduler. Next, deprecations. So there are several operators that accept an optional parameter, scheduler. And most of those operators will change their API. They will not accept this additional scheduler anymore, but only some of them. all the operators related to time, like interval, timer, the delay, all of them will stay the same, but the other ones change their API and they get rid from the additional scheduler parameter. Now execution handling, because I can only introduce you to the new operator if we understand what execution handling is. There are two operators. One of them is called observe on. It helps you to control the emission of events. And the other one is called subscribe on. And this operator helps you to control the subscription. But let's be honest, controlling emission or subscription is really not helpful for us. We don't understand anything. So let's go a little bit more deeper and try to understand what it means. Let's talk about scheduling tasks itself. And let's start with a very simple operator, with the from operator. In this code example, I pass an array with two numbers, 1 and 2, and then I subscribe to this operator and immediately unsubscribe from it. If we take a look at the diagram, the output here is pretty simple. You see the subscription happens, you have the two emissions, and then I unsubscribe. But what happens really? What is scheduling? What are tasks? To understand this, we have to know that there are several task stacks in the browser that get executed in the event loop. There is the normal task stack, that is all the code that is executed synchronously. If you fire a promise, it will be executed on the micro task stack. And if you delay something with a set timeout of 0 or a set interval, it will end up at the macro task stack. Okay, we have these three letters T, I, and A for different stacks. Now let's apply those stacks on the diagram, on the marble diagram. What we see here is that all of those events, subscription, the two emissions, and the unsubscribe, happen in the task stack, so synchronously, marked here. Now, as we know what the task stacks are, we can talk about observe on. Observe on helps us to control the emission of events. Let's look at this diagram here and at the code. We again use the from operator. We have these two items in the array, and then we apply the operator observe on, and we use the asynchronous scheduler. And then again, we subscribe to it and immediately unsubscribe to it. But this time, we don't see any output. Why is this the case? Well, if you take a look at these marked arrows, you see that they switch the stack from a synchronous task stack to the macro task stack. And this is the reason why this code is delayed. So the emission of those events is delayed and will happen after all the synchronous tasks are executed. And this is the reason why they never show up. This is basically how you can control the emission, or in this case, hide the emission of several events. Okay, good. What's subscribe on? I said subscribe on is here to control the time of subscription. Let's try to apply this parameter on our example. And then we see something really strange. We unsubscribe before we subscribe. Crazy, right? Let's take a look at the code. We have again this array. We have the subscribe on operator. We apply the asynchronous scheduler. And then we subscribe to it and immediately unsubscribe to it. If we take a look at the code here, we see that only the unsubscribe is synchronous, and the subscription now moves from the synchronous task stack to the asynchronous task stack internally. So which means that theoretically there would be an error because I subscribe to an unsubscribed observable, but luckily we have this syn wrapper that's called subscriber that takes care. But this is just one example what would happen if you move the subscription moment. Okay, now we know what scheduling tasks means and the current two operators that we can use. Here I marked the important parts, subscribe on, the scheduler and the subscription. And you see that the fat arrow moves from synchronous to asynchronous. Now, as we know all this, we can talk about the new operator in version 7. This operator is a creation method and it is called scheduled. What does scheduled do? Scheduled, as I said, is a creation operator. It is a member of the scheduling group and you can control the subscription and emission of events. You can provide a specific scheduler to do that, and it is more or less a conversion of the from operator. So I'm not sure if you know it, but you can basically put everything into from, an array, a promise, an observable, all those iterables will get created into an array from the from operator. Subscribe on is similar. Let's take a look at observe on to explain you why the scheduled operator is so different. We know that observe on controls the emission of events. What happens is that we move all the emissions together to a separate task stack. So all the emissions together in the same turn of the event loop into the asynchronous stack. And scheduled is even more specific. Let's take a look at this operator scheduled, or this creation method scheduled. We pass an array and then we have an optional third parameter. And in this case, I again use the asynchronous scheduler. If we take a look at our diagram, we see something interesting. We see that every single emission is scheduled in a separate turn of the event loop. If we compare this with the previous operator, we saw that all the emissions are scheduled in the same turn of the event loop. Here we have a separate turn for every single emission. Let me mark it again. And we see that both emissions are in a separate stack and in a separate turn of the event loop. Now let's talk about some refactoring in version 7 and rewrites. So there are different schedulers. There is the queue scheduler, the async scheduler, the animation frame scheduler, and the as soon as possible scheduler. Those schedulers match to the different stacks, and then there are two special schedulers, the virtual time scheduler and the test scheduler. All of those schedulers are refactored to a way smaller and simpler code base in version 7. The animation frame scheduler is now fixed, and as I said before at the beginning, we are now able to schedule some tasks delayed in the future and still run it on the animation frame. This is the line again, and there is another refactoring done, so basically all these actions are more or less refactored away. So this is also one reason why the code base is so much more smaller. And then we have the virtual time scheduler and the test scheduler. And those two schedulers are now completely rewritten. So these are two new files. Every single line of code is rewritten. Several bugs are fixed and several defaults are changed. What changed? The default frame size is now set to 1 millisecond. They basically removed the max frame count, and as I said, those two schedulers are completely rewritten. I prepared a small demo to demonstrate what schedulers do. Is this time here correct, by the way? It shows me 16 minutes. I'm sure this is not true, but okay.
You need to slow it down.
20 minutes time slot.
I'm totally kidding.
Okay. Is the time correct?
Yeah.
Really? Oh, then I have a lot of time. Okay, then let me switch to another demo. Okay, what we have here are two signature pads, two pads that enable me to draw on the screen. The right one is basically recording my drawings, and the left one will animate my drawings in real time. I have two buttons. One button says animate real time, and the second button says show immediately. And what those buttons do is they change the scheduler, which are used internally. So if you take a look at the console, we see that the signature pads record the drawings in segments and points. A segment is basically a line. A line consists of different points. And every point has a timestamp and an X and Y coordinate. This is the reason why I can really animate those drawings in real time. Let me see if I can show you some code. So this is my variable for scheduler, and by default I use the async scheduler. And only if I press the other button, I will apply the virtual time scheduler. What I do is I prepare these signatures, I then use the schedule method and apply my work, which is basically draw this and that point with a specific delay and a state. And if I will click the button, every single point gets executed over those lines. Let's try to demo it. So I draw something, maybe let me reset. And if I click now animate real time, we should see the drawing animated with all my breaks and with all the right timing. So this is done by using the animation frame scheduler. There is this other scheduler that is named Virtual Time Scheduler. And what Virtual Time Scheduler is doing, it basically eliminates time. No matter how long I delay stuff, I will execute it in more or less zero time. Let's try to clear this pad and click the Show Immediate button. And as you can see, the exact same code is now scheduled without anything related to time in 0 milliseconds. And this is, I guess, a very good demonstration how we can use the virtual time scheduler. What else can I show you for version 7? I said all the schedulers are completely rewritten. The maximum frame size is now 1 millisecond. This would mean that the virtual time frame scheduler, for example, is faster in the latest version. And what I can show you is why it is slow in this version. So if I do a lot of drawings, this should be enough, and I click the Show Immediate button, you will realize that there is a slight delay, and I click it now, and it takes some time, and then it shows up. So these are all the frames that we have to wait for. And this delay is basically shortened in the latest version, and we can also configure it. Perfect. Let's switch back. Okay, yeah, this was the demo. Oh, yeah, okay. Woo! So exciting, amazing. Let's recap what we heard. There are these bug fixes. We can now use the animation frame scheduler and schedule something late. There is this deprecations in the API, all the creation methods, and most of the other operators that accept an optional parameter, an optional scheduler, are now deprecated, and you cannot use the scheduler there. But we have this new creation method that is called scheduled instead, and we can and should use this new creation method. Also, all schedulers are refactored, and two of them, the virtual time scheduler and the test scheduler, are completely rewritten. This is basically more or less everything that is now present in the current pull request. For sure, there will be some changes because nobody really knows when they will release version 7, but this is, I guess, a very good overview what you can expect. One last thing before I finish, all those diagrams, I finish now. Little bit confused. So okay, you're expert. You're now really expert, not only in RxJS, but also in the latest version. It's not even out there. And what you do if you're expert, you go to your boss and ask for a salary raise. Thanks. All the diagrams are based on the Marble design system that I'm working on. So if you're interested about those diagrams, please picture the URL. And all the resources, slides, and links are listed here. If you're interested in this event loop stuff, please watch all the videos you can get from Jake Archibald. Thanks.